Hello guys, this is Hybrid Financial Consultants and welcome again to financial reporting or financial accounting. And today we're just going to take a look at a new accounting standard, another accounting standard, IAS 10. That is events after reporting period. What are events after reporting period actually? Suppose we have a financial year starting 1st January and ending 31st December. Events after reporting period are those events that occur after 31st December, after the end of the accounting period. For example, 31st December, that's just an example, but before the financial statements are authorized for issue. So those are events after reporting period, just as the definition speaks for itself. Your accounting period started 1st January, it ends 31st December, then those events that occur after 31st December, but before financial statements are authorized for issue, that is before they are signed. All those are events of the reporting period. So as the definition states here, events of the reporting period are those events. Events could be favorable, but also could be unfavorable. It doesn't matter. We don't care whether the events are favorable or unfavorable. As long as they have occurred after the end of the reporting period, no problem. We just regard them as the events of the reporting period. And also we are told here that which occur between the reporting date and the date on which the financial statements are authorized for issue. For example, by the board of directors. Actually in a company, those who authorize actually depends that for those companies that have a board of directors, those authorizing could be board of directors, but actually it could be any kind of representative used by the company in case the company doesn't have the board of directors. And so actually this standard is very short. There are just two types of events of the reporting period. We have adjusting events, but also we have non-adjusting events. So when speaking of adjusting and non-adjusting events, what we refer to? By adjusting events, when you just say about adjusting events, it means that there are events that give you additional evidence of conditions that existed at the end of the period. If they give you evidence of conditions that existed at the end of the period, that means they should be incorporated into the financial statements. And so if the name itself states adjusting, so we adjust for them. But non-adjusting events are events that occur at the reporting period, but they give no evidence of conditions that existed. They are new events that come into light, but also they just give evidence of conditions that arose after the end of the period. So no, we need no adjustments actually. Most of the time we just disclose if we see that they are so important. So this standard is just about adjusting as well as non-adjusting events. So here I say that financial statements are prepared on the basis of conditions existing at the reporting date. This is the key point. Even in the definitions I just stated, we base here. Look here. Are prepared on the basis of conditions existing at the reporting date. We look at conditions existing at the reporting date. If your financial year ends at 1st December, then you look at 1st December. Are these events of the reporting period showing evidence of conditions that existed at the reporting date or not? If they are, they are adjusting events. If not, they are non-adjusting events. So that's what you have to do. And so we come here, you have adjusting events. As I've told you earlier, that adjusting events are those that provide evidence of conditions. Just be specific, evidence of conditions that existed at the end of the reporting period. These are what we call adjusting events. And an adjusting event is the reverse. So actually, these are just examples. And an exam might be asked, you might be given several scenarios so that you can explain what they are adjusting, non-adjusting, and give reasons. So these are examples of adjusting events. First of all, this is just an example. Sale of inventory after the reporting date for less than its carrying amount. All right. Let's say that you purchased inventory at $200. And then up to the end of the accounting period, you value that inventory at $200. But let's say 5 days after the reporting date, you sell the inventory, but instead of that $200, actually, you sell the inventory maybe for, because that was your cost, you expected to sell beyond that $200. But let's say, suppose that you sell them at $150. That only goes to show you that the inventory's worth is much less compared to what you had valued them. And you have to remember that this is inventory. International Accounting Standard number 2 explains valuation of inventory. Inventory is measured at the law of cost and net realizable value. We look at the law of cost and net realizable value. So since the net realizable value will be less, that goes to show us that we value inventory higher. You have valued your inventory, so you have to make an adjustment. That's why we say sale of inventory after the reporting date for less than its carrying amount, not just selling. For example, inventory cost us $200, but we, after the reporting date, we sold it for $250. That would indicate no problem because it wouldn't be an adjusting event. So you have to understand very carefully. It's not the transaction itself that counts to be adjusted. It's not that sale that is accounted for. What we account for is the inventory that was existing at the year end. Why? It gives evidence about net realizable value of inventory at the reporting date. And we know that according to International Accounting Standard number 2, inventory is valued at the law of cost and net realizable value. So I hope everything is clear about this example here. You have to understand what you are doing. All right, let's look at another example. Actually, this standard is just about examples, so you can just get used to it in an easy way. All right, let's see here. Bankruptcy of a customer after the reporting date. At first, we are not aware that your customer was in a bankruptcy state. Let's say he was your credit customer. Let's say company A was your credit customer. You had sold goods to it and on credit. And so you expected, you had the receivables. You have trade receivables in the statement of financial position, expecting to receive the amount from that customer. But shortly after the reporting date, you realize that the customer has undergone bankruptcy. This only goes to show that you should, because actually when measuring the receivables, we have bad debts, but also we have provision for bad debts. You should have anticipated that and you should have made a provision for doubtful debts as well as bad debts. So because we hadn't done that before, you have to do it. And so it becomes an adjusting event. Why? Reason here. It confirmed that the allowance is required against the receivable balance at the reporting date. So you have to find something like this. And then I'll have another example here. Discovery of fraud or errors. Fraud or errors. Actually, in a company, when we discover fraud or error, that means that actually the financial statements were done in the wrong way. So it's very much obvious that you have to adjust. I think this doesn't need much explanation because it's obvious there was fraud or there was an error. You have to rectify such errors or fraud. That's why it showed that the financial statements are incorrect. Anything incorrect should be corrected. I think this has got no issue. And then another example here. You are told a settlement of a court case after the reporting period. Settlement of a court case after the reporting period. What of this? Actually, after learning I-37, that speaks of provisions, contingent assets, and contingent liabilities, you'll have a much deeper knowledge about this example here. But actually, when speaking of settlement of a court case after the reporting period, let's say that you had a customer who consumed the services of your company, and then the customer suffered damage and they sued. But before, actually, you as a company saw that the customer wouldn't get anything. You just saw that, oh, all right, this is the customer, but actually this customer is not going to win this case. And so if you saw that the customer is not going to win this, well, welcome, Abraham, welcome. And if you saw that the customer isn't going to win this case, you could have just written a contingent liability. A contingent liability, anything contingent is not recognized in the financial statements. And so you would have just stayed, waiting for the real thing to happen. But then shortly after the end, you have just realized that you had to settle. Settlement of the court case has proved that you actually owe the customer, you have to pay. And so that liability, which you initially hadn't recognized, actually you have to recognize it by that time. And so by having to do that, you have to adjust your financial statements. That's why you say here, it confirmed the existence and the value of the entity's obligations at the reporting date, something like this. So you have to be careful when incorporating something like this. Welcome, Ibrahim. Welcome. Welcome, friend. Welcome. Ibrahim, you get me? Hello, Ibrahim. I hope you are hearing me, actually. But also, we could have another example about adjusting events. We are told here that evidence of a permanent diminution in property value prior to the year end. Maybe value of property has fallen, things like this. So we could also have something like this here. We could see something like this here, determination after the year end of the sale or purchase price of assets sold or purchased before the year end. So these are just other examples. So let's finish up with non-adjusting events. So first of all, events that are adjusting are considered into adjusting financial statements, but non-adjusting events are not considered in adjusting financial statements. So let's finish up with these non-adjusting events. What are non-adjusting events as long as International Accounting Standard number 10 is concerned? They are just events that are indicative of conditions that arose after the reporting period. So what? If they indicate situation that arose after the reporting date, that means that they have nothing to do with the financial statements as of the year end. So no need to adjust. And normally they are disclosed when it is considered to be useful. So the following are examples of non-adjusting events. So you as a company, you as an accountant of a company should not treat the following as adjusting events because they are non-adjusting events. First of all, look at this, a major business combination after the reporting date or disposal of a major subsidiary. This is just one example. If you have gone a bit about consolidation of financial statements, actually I'm just going to have a deeper knowledge of what I'm going to speak about. Speaking of a business combination is, for example, acquiring someone. You have just acquired company, you are company A, you have just acquired company B by 70%, 80%, 90%, or maybe 100% soon after the reporting date. So we know that when you acquire a company, you have to prepare, it could happen that you have to prepare consolidated financial statement. So you won't need to make such adjustments if you have done it after the reporting period. But also we are told here that announcing a plan after the reporting date to discontinue an operation. We know we got a standard called IFRS 5, and that standard is about non-current assets held for sale and discontinued operations. So when dealing with that, actually, it has to have occurred within actually the accounting period concerned. So if it occurs after the reporting date, you treat it as a non-adjusting event. Then something like this. So you have to relate it somehow to IFRS 5. So actually this standard just speaks generally, the general way of all standards. There are standards like this one, you have to cope with them. But also here we are told that major purchases and disposals of assets after the reporting date. The major purchase, for example, the year just ended, maybe after 5, 7 days, 10 days, you haven't signed the financial statements, are not yet, to be signed. And then you have purchased a major asset or have disposed an asset, no need to adjust, no need to make an adjustment for the period that has just ended. Ibrahim, I hope you are hearing me. Ibrahim, also another example here, destruction of assets by fire after the reporting date. You have the assets, they have been destroyed by fire after the reporting date. Let's take a good example. Let's just go back here and look at, I initially gave an example of inventory here. I said that sale of inventory for the year end at an amount that is less, at a value that is less than what? Than its own cost. Now, this is another example. Let's say you've destroyed inventory. Destruction of inventory. Actually, if inventory is destroyed, it will fall in value. That's right. But you have to remember that inventory will have fallen in value, but that would not be giving evidence of condition that existed at the year end, because at the year end, everything was fine, all was well. So actually, this wouldn't be an adjusting event. So it would end up being an unadjusting event. But also there are other examples here. We are just told that announcing or commencing a major restructuring after the reporting date. You at the company, 10 days, let's say, after the reporting date, you have just said that, or maybe you are just planning to close down some divisions, or maybe you have just decided that you as a company, actually, you have a plan, formal and detailed, that you are just going to change maybe the operations. Maybe you change them from one region to the other, things like that. And so actually, this will not be an adjusting event. So there are things like this, but there are just other examples like this one. Large changes after the reporting date in foreign exchange rates. The reporting date has passed, there has been a change of foreign exchange rates, because actually it can happen. You could be in the US operating on US dollars, and then you could be buying goods, let's say from London, in pounds. And what if there had been a foreign exchange change in foreign exchange rates after the year end? Actually, that is not going to affect the financial statements in the period concerned. So there are things like these ones. Yeah, equity dividend declared or proposed at the reporting date. Actually, we'll speak of dividends in a separate section, but actually, if you have dividend declared or proposed after the reporting date, they're not going to affect actually the financial statement at the year end. But there are just other normal examples here, and obvious one, changes in tax rates or tax laws at the reporting date. The reporting date is end in that case December, and then 10 days later, tax laws change. You cannot say that because tax laws have changed, then I have to compute the taxes for the previous period using these current changes. You can just proceed. You cannot adjust the financial statement just because of that. So actually, such are examples of non-adjusting events. Now, to wind up our lesson, let's just finish up with these matters. I think in about 10 minutes, we will have completed. So non-adjusting events do not affect any items in the statement of financial position or statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income. This is something that is worth noting. You have to understand this. Non-adjusting events will not affect the financial statements like this, profit or loss, financial position. They are normally just disclosed. However, for material, you have to note this one. However, for material non-adjusting events, I still require the following disclosure. So you just have to disclose them in their own way. You have to understand the meaning of disclosing. Actually, incorporating items in the financial statements, profit also in the financial position, this also means disclosing. But actually, when we are speaking of disclosures here, as we have said, do not disclose them in the financial position or profit also in the other comprehensive income, but rather just disclose them in the notes. For example, you can just describe your event, what actually happened, but also, you can just estimate, maybe for example, if the tax rate has changed, you can explain it, but also it's estimated financial effect or a statement that such an estimate cannot be made. So for example, maybe our tax rate has changed, you explain, tax rate has changed, and then you could say that, okay, if I had to incorporate this, my tax liability, let's say, or tax expense would have increased by this much amount, or would have decreased by this much amount, but actually you want to incorporate it in the statement of financial position or the statement of profit or loss and other comprehensive income. I hope everything is well. So here we're just going to dividends here, as you see, dividends. Well, how do we treat dividends? As far as I stand, even if the reporting period is concerned. Actually, the good thing is I've already explained it here. I explained it here, equity dividends. The treatment is just the same, but you usually put it in a separate section here. If an entity declares dividends after the reporting period, the entity shall not recognize such dividends as a liability at the end of the reporting period as the year non-adjusting events. I hope you have noted this one. If an entity declares dividends after the reporting period, the period has just ended, maybe 15 days later or 2 weeks later, the company has declared dividends. You cannot say that these dividends, just because they are just for the previous period, they read that period. They do not give evidence of conditions that existed at the year end. And so they are treated as non-adjusting events. I can see a message here. Ibrahim, please, can you avail the PDF notes? Yes, I've just seen your text, Ibrahim. Yes, I can. I'll just share it in the group. I'll share it in the group if you're just hearing me. I'm just finalizing here. Just about 10 minutes will be done. All right, so if dividends, only dividends that are declared before the end of the reporting period can be incorporated into the financial statement, they have been declared, they can be treated as a liability if they are yet to be paid. So only necessary disclosure is required. So you really have to start the question and then try to answer. Actually, in the next lecture, I will just be solving questions. There are questions down here, but for today, I can just go and finish up with this going concern. Let's finish this going concern concept, and all these are questions. They're just questions. But actually, the lecture ends here, end after this page here. So just be patient a bit. So let's go to going concern issues. Let's go to going concern issues arising after the reporting date. How do we go about these going concern issues arising after the reporting date? So first, it's just the normal rule. There is an exception to the rule that financial statements reflect conditions at the reporting date. Why? If after the reporting date, the management decides to liquidate the entity or cease trading, the financial statements cannot be prepared on a going concern basis. I think we know this. We just say that even after the reporting period, any event that gives evidence of condition that did not exist at the end of the period is an unadjusted event. But actually, there is a huge difference when it comes to going concern. Going concern, actually, I hope you know the meaning of going concern. Going concern simply means that the entity has neither need nor intention to liquidate or curtail materially the scale of its operations. That's the meaning of going concern. So the entity has neither need nor intention. What do I mean by need or intention? By need, it means that the company may not want to actually to liquidate, but they have no way, maybe they're insolvent. It's a voluntary liquidation, but also they can just decide, oh, let's wind up this company so that we form another one, we form a new one. So in case the accounting period has ended and maybe 2 weeks later, the company actually is not going to be a going concern, actually we have to consider that as an adjusting event, because the going concern concept is the basis at which financial statements are prepared. Going back to the conceptual framework, you will learn that the going concern basis actually is the accounting assumption. It is the assumption even in the conceptual framework of financial reporting. So in case there is something like that, actually you have to consider back. That's why I told you that in accordance with IS1, which is preparation of financial statements, management must disclose any material uncertainties relating to events or conditions that cast a significant doubt upon the entity's ability to continue going concern. And this applies even if the events have arisen since the reporting period. So there is something very, very worth noting. You as the company, if even after the reporting period, you find that there is material uncertainty, you have to disclose that one, but still prepare financial statements on a going concern day. But in case actually going concern assumption is no longer appropriate, let's say the company has decided, maybe the shareholder of the company have decided to wind up the company, to close it down so that they open a new one, that means the entity will not be a going concern. And so, if the going concern assumption is no longer appropriate, if it is no longer appropriate, then I stand state that a fundamental change on the basis of accounting is required. And if the fundamental change is required, most of times actually companies use the breakup basis. Let's say your company is just going to close down. So if the company is going to close down, actually you need to use another basis. We usually call it a breakup basis. All assets are treated as current assets. Or liabilities could be to these current liabilities. And then you value them at their piecemeal values, at their value that they can be disposed of easily. So we say, in this case, the entities will prepare the financial statements on the breakup basis. This one, usually a breakup basis. Meaning that assets and liabilities are measured at their piecemeal value, things like this. So in case the financial statements are not prepared on a going concern basis, the fact must be disclosed. Whenever you're not preparing the financial statements on a breakup basis, actually, the fact must be disclosed. Everything must be known that to those users of financial statements, the stakeholders of the company. So these are just questions, just examples. We can just take a look at this one example, and then we'll look at further examples as time goes on. So let's just look at the example one. Example two, I'll just leave it. Then there is example three. Example three is a very, very detailed example. So we'll check it another day. But first of all, let's just try to take a look at this example. Number one, the following material events have occurred after the reporting period, but prior to the date of approval of the financial statements. That means all these are events after the reporting period. So first of all, we are told we have Roman 1 to Roman 4, then required, state whether the events above are adjusting or non-adjusting events. So you just try to ask yourself this question, what would you have answered had it been you? First of all, the insolvency of a major credit customer, you had a credit customer, that means you had the trade receivables in your account, and then the customer has just been insolvent. So the customer that's been insolvent, that means he will not be able to pay you. And this only shows that you should have anticipated this. You should have provided for bad debts as well as for provision for bad for doubtful debts. And if you hadn't done that, actually you have to incorporate it. So it did obviously be an adjusting event, something like that. That's example one. Let's go to another, Roman 2 here. The uninsured loss of inventory in a fire. Uninsured loss, you had inventory, and then inventory was burnt in a fire after the reporting date, but inventory was burnt in a fire. So look at this one. Inventory was burnt after the reporting date. That shows that it is an event after the reporting period. Then should it be adjusting or non-adjusting? If you look at, does it give you evidence of conditions that existed at the year end or not? Actually, this uninsured loss in a fire, this fire broke out after the reporting date, and so it's pretty much obvious that it is an non-adjusting event because the fire broke out after the reporting date. And the good thing here, you have been told uninsured loss. So you have to distinguish. This inventory had no insurance. In case the inventory had insurance, you as the company would be able to recoup your amount, your cost. You would be able to recoup your cost back. And so there will be no need to adjust the financial statements. So learn how to differentiate here. This is insured, uninsured. Suppose it was insured, what would you have done? Consider that. So this will be an unadjusting event. And then go to number three here, we are told that the proposal of a final equity dividend, I think you have spoken about this in much, much detail. Dividend has been proposed, even if it has been declared at the year end. So actually there's nothing to do here. It's just an unadjusting event, so you could just disclose it. So this is an unadjusting event. And then here we are told that a change in the foreign exchange rates. As I said earlier, foreign exchange rates has changed and it's after the reporting date. So you cannot adjust anything because it does not give you evidence of condition that existed at the end. So something like this, this is just one example. You have a second example here. And then you could have another example. For example, we have example number three here. This is Roman one. Actually, we'll check this in another example. We'll do the full example, this example three, we'll do it all in full because there are very, very important points here. And then there are examples like this one, number four. This is diploma in IFRS hosted by ACCA. It's from June 2015. You could look with, and then I have a CPA Ireland example. We'll check out all these examples so that you get better and better and better. All right, thank you very much for today. And I hope that we'll meet next time and we'll learn more. If you haven't subscribed, you can subscribe to support us, but also to learn more and to receive all necessary updates. Thank you very much.